Good morning. The President of Telangana Academy of Sciences, Professor Narasimha Reddy Garu, respected guest of honor, Eminent Sri Govardhan Mehtaji, Professor Govardhan Mehtaji, Director of IICT, Sri Chandrasekhar Garu, Dr. Chandrasekhar Garu. Mimmalnaithe Dr. Anuchu Kadandi. Former Director of CCMB and also the first President of TAS, Dr. Mohan Rao Garu, Dr. Venugopal Reddy Garu, and Dr. Sanjeev Reddy Garu. And to the distinguished audience, young fellows, I was told this was a gathering of some young scientists and also some very, very eminent researchers. I didn't know that off late research actually started at the age of two, because kontamandi chinna pillalu kuda kanapadutunnaru, so delighted to have them as well, you know. I have a written speech because I didn't want to take chances, you know, because this is a distinguished gathering, I was told, and therefore I didn't want to come across like I don't belong here, so therefore I have a written speech. But before I go in there, in fact, I must thank you for this opportunity, because as somebody who's been associated with biological sciences at some point, as Govardhan Mehtaji said, even I feel old, you know. At some point, back in 90s, I was also a student of biological sciences. I have as was mentioned, I have a bachelor's degree in microbiology, and then also I moved to studying biotechnology and animal tissue culture for a bit. So I do have a certain exposure, but I can't claim to be any kind of an expert on, or any kind of, I can't even claim to have knowledge of any kind. At least after getting into politics, I think all of that has vanished. So mostly it's all the political knowledge that I have. But before I go into that, I would like to bring you up to speed on two, three things. Firstly, I am delighted that I got an opportunity to be here. Before I actually go into my written speech, let me quickly give you an update on what we've been doing as a state, especially with respect to the different advancements and where Telangana Academy of Sciences can play a very important role. Three things that immediately come to my mind, and that actually I have jotted down after I've come here. If you look at the kind of investments the state of Telangana has been making on irrigation, in the last 4 years, in the four budgets that we have presented, we've in fact outlaid, in fact, the investment that we have put in our state budget towards increasing the irrigable land, towards increasing, you know, the water facility for all the cultivable lands in the state of Telangana is approximately 100,000 crores or 1 lakh crores. This is huge, and this is gigantic by any stretch of imagination. In fact, this year alone, from the budget, we would be spending about 25,000 crores. And outside of the budget, in fact, through extra budgetary provisions, we'd be raising 12,000 crores more. So 37,000 crores of money will be invested this year alone into constructing large dams, barrages, large reservoirs, and all of this with an intention, with an intent of ensuring that out of the total allocated 1,200 TMCs of water in both River Krishna and Godavari, we shall and we should use every single drop of water. By 2021, we would want to be that state which has completely exhausted all of its resources with respect to irrigation and has achieved saturation in terms of ensuring that 1 crore acres of land, 10 million acres of land in Telangana are completely irrigated through Krishna and Godavari. Right now it's about 2 million acres. So 20 lakh acres is what is under irrigation. So what we're looking to achieve is nearly a quintuple fold jump in terms of, which is a huge, a very ambitious, very audacious effort if you ask me. And in a country through seeing irrigation projects unfold over decades. For example, the Sri Ram Sagar project that was grounded by late Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru. The phase two of it is still ongoing, by the way, just to give you a sense of how quickly things have moved in the past or how slowly things have happened in the past. So therefore, to look at what has happened in the past, to juxtapose that with what is happening now, is truly in itself, by no stretch of imagination, possibly one of the biggest records that our state is going to create. A project like Kaleshwaram, for example. For those of you who have not been there, for those of you who have not visited or not aware of it and the scale of it, I would strongly urge Chandrasekhar Garu and also Telangana Academy of Sciences to kindly lead a delegation to actually visit this site and to actually experience it yourself, the breakneck speed at which projects are unfolding. The reason why I say this, is because once we have water, once we have another 80 lakh acres of land coming under cultivation in the next 5 years, I think Telangana has to prioritize, because we keep hearing about distress in agriculture all the time. And agri-sciences, I'm sure, is one of the most important aspects of Telangana Academy of Sciences also. Agricultural distress, all said and done, in spite of what we are as a country, in spite of our achievements in science and technology, still 65% of the population, or at least 60+% of the dependent heavily on agriculture or allied activities. So therefore, my request to Telangana Academy of Sciences is, please take this as a request from the state government. Make it a mandate for your young fellows and young scientists to understand and to come out with a crop pattern and crop colony pattern, crop culture pattern, and to guide us. Because in our country, traditionally what we have seen is whenever there is water, typically farmers would tend to gravitate towards paddy, or would tend to gravitate towards certain crop types which are easy to go about, and where they also have, I can't blame them, because they have a fair deal of understanding compared to other crops. So therefore, my request to Telangana Academy of Sciences is, if you can, come out with a plan for the state of Telangana over the next 5 years and then the 10-year plan, and give us a guidance and tell us exactly how to go about this, maybe by also partnering and involving organizations like ICRISAT, possibly NGRA as well, and maybe a lot of, the University of Agriculture, Professor Jayashankar University of Agriculture. So my request is, if you can help us on this aspect, that would be a huge, huge asset to the state of Telangana. The second thing I also wanted to point out, today's biggest challenge for any government across the world, be it Honorable KCRG's government in Telangana or President Donald Trump's government in the United States, the biggest challenge for any government today is employment, or addressing the issue of unemployment. Now, as you all obviously understand, the employment in the government sector is limited. So therefore, every government makes a very strong, concerted effort to attract investment in the private sector and to actually be the best in the world in terms of attracting investment and to create infrastructure that's the best in the world. Now, especially when you're competing on a global scale, and especially when you're competing with countries like China, you need scale. You need scale on your side. Otherwise, your competitive advantage, your cost advantage will go away immediately, will dissipate immediately. Consequent to that thinking, we came out with the idea of creating the world's largest pharma cluster in the city of Hyderabad, consolidating and leveraging our strength, as Professor Govardhan Mehta pointed out. This is possibly, arguably, the science capital of India, Hyderabad City. We wanted to ensure that the life sciences capital of India tag and the science capital of India, the research capital of India tag, is consolidated by way of creating the world's largest pharma cluster, attract more investments into this sector, bulk drugs, formulations, chemicals, research and development, manufacturing, and create the world's largest pharma cluster in about 19,000 acres of land. Now, the reason why we wanted this scale is because, like I mentioned, when you're competing with the likes of China, when you're competing with the likes of some countries, especially in Asia, which are now also competing with India on an even keel, we wanted to ensure that we have enough scale to be able to give that cost competitive advantage to the manufacturers and to the industry, which also, of course, creates a great deal of employment to our youngsters here. The unfortunate thing is, with industrialization come some preconceived notions, preconceived biases, some prejudices. Now, our experience in the past in Patancheru, in Ramchandrapuram, in GD Metla, in Balanagar, with chemical industries, with bulk drugs industries, has not been great. Part of it can be attributed to the lackadaisical enforcement of the Pollution Control Board norms. For those of you who live in Kudbullapur, for those of you who live in Ramchandrapuram or Patancheru, I think you can empathize better, because people there, victims of neglect, let me put it that way. Part of it can be attributed to the greed of the industry. Part of it can be attributed to the lackadaisical, like I said, enforcement of the pollution control norms. Now, as a result, what happens is, when we wanted to create Hyderabad Pharma City, there is an obvious prejudice, there is an obvious bias, a negative bias towards what is possibly one huge employment generator. Now, I request Telangana Academy of Sciences to get into an active engagement with citizens, an active engagement with the people of that area in about 9 villages, and Shakti can guide you, the Director of Life Sciences, to ensure that we dispel. Because while we continue to maintain, while we continue to mention to the people there that we will be following the strictest of norms, zero liquid discharge. We have done some studies even on the wind flow patterns. In the, like the Tuas Industrial City in Singapore, we have in fact gone there, done massive amount of research. We've engaged someone like Surbana Jurong, who's planned some of the best science parks in the world. In spite of all that, unfortunately, there's a prejudice. There is a certain prefixed, preconceived ideas about the harm that pharma industry can cause. Now, I request Telangana Academy of Sciences also to play an active role, because all said and done, government is looked at as a stakeholder with a vested interest. Now, Telangana Academy of Sciences, as an independent body, as Professor Mehta put it, a body which is in the NGO mode or the quasi-government mode, can help us, especially with the kind of eminent researchers, eminent panel you have. You can talk to them, you can tell them that we will take upon ourselves the onus of ensuring that government and the industry there follows the strictest of norms. A common effluent treatment plant, without a single drop of effluent discharge trickling into the water, into the ground there. How can we ensure that all of this is handled? That is the second point I wanted to put up. And the third thing I also wanted to put up is urbanization and its consequences. As we all know, Hyderabad as a city is consistently rated as a city with the best quality of living. For the last 3 years, in fact, I must share this with you. An agency called Mercer, which rates cities on a livability index across the world, has been rating Hyderabad as a city with the best quality of living in India. But as we all admit, as we all know, as people who travel the world, as people who see other cities and the way they have been shaping up, while things have been slowly but steadily improving in the city of Hyderabad, the law and order situation has improved significantly in the last 4 years. The water supply has been increasing, has increased substantially in the last 4 years. The power situation, which was very erratic prior to the formation of Telangana, has improved substantially in the last 4 years. But there are still areas where we have to get our act together. One of the significant challenges with respect to Hyderabad is the rapid urbanization that's happening here. Not just Hyderabad, but in fact, every single urban agglomeration faces this problem. My request to Telangana Academy of Sciences also on this front is, a lot of times urbanization leads to negative consequences, especially with respect to environment and infrastructure. Now, I would request you to also possibly form a subcommittee on this and guide us, especially the impact on environment, because I'm sure there are scientists and there are fellows who are from the environmental sciences background. We would request you to work with us, because we have our own plans. Of course, we parallelly are working on it. About 192 forest blocks within 100-kilometer radius around Hyderabad are being developed as urban lung spaces. We are working on that, and we continue to work on that. We are working on Musi beautification and Musi cleaning and liquid waste management in the city of Hyderabad. And we are consistently making efforts to ramp up our urban infrastructure. But I think these three areas, like I said, irrigation, possibly a subcommittee, and guiding us with what kind of crop colonies can come up. Because monocropping will destroy soil fertility, as we all know. And monocropping, of course, is detrimental, even in terms of the farmers getting a fair price in the market. So therefore, a possible subcommittee on that, and a second possible subcommittee on how to sensitize people on the good consequences, the positive consequences of industrial employment, and how can we even tackle the pollution hazards that have happened in the past. Because a lot of things are fresh in the minds of people. You know, the Bhopal tragedy, the unfortunate tragedies, even inside or close to the city of Hyderabad. And also, if Professor Narasimha Reddy can guide the government on these three fronts, I'll be grateful. Now, like many of you, I also very strongly believe science and innovation are the primary drivers of long-run economic growth. Most of the enterprises that have come about in the world today have come out from some premier scientific labs, have come out from some brilliant minds. Now, the only way for sustained employment provision is by way of encouraging the private sector, by way of encouraging innovation, by way of encouraging more and more enterprise and free market economy. Now, that's something government of Telangana has been doing, championing, in fact, consistently. That's why we're ranked number one on the ease of doing business index, which is a joint ranking, which is a ranking given by both DIPP and also the World Bank jointly together. We're delighted that we've been consistently maintaining that position. But at the same time, I think what's equally important to realize, in fact, when we were sitting up in the director's room and chatting, he said something very nonchalantly, which I latched onto and which I teased him about also. He said, you know, we've published a lot of papers in many, many journals, which people hardly bother to read. My request to all the scientists in this room is, you know, I possibly could have ended up and, you know, joined one of you if I had gone on after my post-graduation to pursue a PhD. But my question to all of you, and at least some of you, is most of the science, most of the research that happens in our country, unfortunately, remains either in beautiful and wonderful publications, you know, the science journals across the world and across India as well, or is confined to the wonderful institutions that we so proudly cherish. See, CCMB, for example, or IICT, or some of the other wonderful names, in fact, in our own state, NGRI, like I said, NIN, CFTRI, ICRISAT, IDPL, et cetera, et cetera. All of these are truly eminent institutions which have really, really provided this country and the world great deal of inputs and great deal of amazing interventions with respect to science. But how much of it is actually known? How much of this research that happens in these eminent scientific institutions has had a commercial application? In a country like India, the reason why I say this is because in a country like India, unfortunately, science and scientific research still has a very elitist image. You might not like what I said. You may not be happy with what I'm saying. The fact is, the scientific research in this country, in our country, still has a tag which is extremely elitist and which is not identified by the common man of India. I'm talking as a common man, as a citizen here. I'm not saying we don't cherish your achievements. We do. When ISRO, the Indian Space Research Organization, you know, sends 100 satellites in one go, we all take absolute pride. While we don't know what these 100 satellites are going to do, we all take great deal of pride and we derive a great deal of pleasure that India is also making significant advancements in science and technology, in space technology. I'm sure whenever one of our scientists wins one of the big awards, we all take a great deal of pride and our chest swells with pride, but we really don't know what you want it for. The point I'm trying to make is a country like India needs homegrown recipes with the kind of problems we have. A country like India needs you to focus on the problems at the ground level. When I was at DRDO and RCI, last year, they told me something which was extremely heartening. They said for our soldiers who are working in Siachen to protect our country, to protect our homeland, we've been able to come out and discover a bacteria which helps them handle their sanitation better in such adverse conditions. So that is in my head, in my mind, as a layman, as an absolute layman, as a citizen of this country. That is science that is going to help my country, that is going to help me get some things done in the right manner. My appeal to all of you. See, we have certain challenges. For example, healthcare. Healthcare in India, in fact, not just in India, but also across the world. I've lived in the US for about 8 years. It's one of the most hotly debated subjects. I keep getting a lot of requests in social media. I'm very active in social media. I keep getting a lot of requests in social media asking for assistance, financial assistance, to provide quality healthcare through a private sector hospital. Now, a lot of times, my mind keeps darting back to the same question. You know, we have Aarogyashri, which you all know, a universal health coverage, which covers nearly 1,000 different kind of ailments. If you have a white ration card, which is for anybody who's below the poverty line, which I'm presuming none of you in this room have, we provide, you know, Aarogyashri coverage. But in spite of that, in spite of now Government of India talking about a scheme called Ayushman Bhava, a medical coverage, the Medicare in this country, the healthcare, is quite expensive for a common man, for an ordinary middle-class man in this country. Now, if you ask me, our brilliant scientific minds with their scientific temperament should possibly work on lowering the healthcare costs in India. Medical devices that we import, more than 70% of the med devices that are deployed in the corporate hospitals or even government hospitals in India today are imported from abroad. Now, why can't we work on solutions? Why can't we work on indigenous solutions which substantially will lower the cost of healthcare? So my request, again, without really offending any of your sensibilities, is that this elitist image of scientific institutions in India, because a lot of people do not know what goes inside the walls of IICT or CCMB. I would go to the extent of saying 95% of Hyderabad does not know what goes on inside. I know you throw open your doors every so often to the young children, to the children from schools, so that they can come, experience, and I'm sure Telangana Academy of Sciences also is publishing journals in vernacular so that dissemination of science is happening even at a primary school and upper primary school level. All of this is good work. But I think at somewhere, if we can break that mental barrier that science and scientific research in this country is not catering to the needs of the common man of this country, I think you would have done, you would have really given this country a great deal of hope, and you would have also taken that leap of faith, which I think is much, much needed at this point in time for our generation at least, because a lot of us who have grown up and who are looking at this country and who travel the world as well, typically end up lamenting all the time about countries like Japan, which have progressed by leaps and bounds in the last few decades, even after an explosion of a nuclear weapon on their soil, on their land. They've been able to catapult themselves into the top league in spite of the natural handicap, in spite of not having natural resources, in spite of not having any natural resources. In fact, let me put it that way. Countries like South Korea have done exceptionally well and are one of the top economies in the world, in spite of their limitations with respect to size, in spite of their, countries in Europe have done well, in spite of their limitations with respect to language. China has done exceptionally well. So India, with all the ingredients of greatness, India with all of its amazing abilities to be able to break into the big league and to be able to actually drive this world, unfortunately has not been able to get its basics right. We as a government are taking pride, the state government of Telangana, that we are going to be providing a potable drinking water connection to each and every home in the next 4 months. But in fact, if you ask me, it's a shame that a government has to talk about it proudly 70 years after independence. It should have been done possibly a few decades ago. Entire country, not just Telangana. After 70 years of independence, here's a government which says, I'm going to give a potable drinking water connection to each and every home, and we talk about it. Where is it as actually a basic necessity? Where have we missed the plot? Where have we failed our country? I mean, collective leaderships over the last few decades. On the one hand, we hear Union Energy Minister talking about how our country is going to produce 175 gigabits of solar energy, renewable energy. On the other hand, we also hear him talking about how our country is a surplus power country. But at the same time, we have to remind ourselves there are thousands of villages out there which are languishing without electrification. So we as a country, in fact, our Honorable Chief Minister yesterday also pointed out something extremely important. 70,000 TMCs of water is available in our country today. The collective water in all the wonderful rivers that flow through the Putra, Ganga, Godavari, Krishna, Narmada, 70,000 TMCs. Now, if you look at the complete water needs of this country in terms of irrigation, in terms of drinking water, in terms of industrialization, it will not exceed more than 40,000 TMCs. Even if you harness and even if you saturate and even if you leverage every single drop that is required for the consumption in this country, you'll still have 30,000 TMCs of surplus water. Well, what a shame that this country still has famine-struck areas. What a shame that this country still has no drinking water in millions and millions of households. So there are a lot of things, which I am anguished about, like many of you, I'm pretty sure. But my request to you, having said all this, is to basically ensure, at least Telangana Academy of Sciences, to take up a few challenges, maybe. To take up a few. I'm not asking you to boil the ocean. I know what I've said possibly is information overload for many of you right now. But at the same time, I think Telangana Academy of Sciences can take it upon itself as a mandate and maybe start endeavoring towards at least solving one, two, or three problems and assist the government in its efforts to do more. We've launched our own effort called RICH, the Research and Innovation Circle of Hyderabad, exactly to alleviate the problem I've mentioned, exactly to overcome this hurdle of the elitist tag that scientific institutions have. We wanted to ensure that the research that happens in these scientific institutions happens in collaboration with the industry needs, because industry is directly linked to the market and market demand. So we wanted to ensure that a tie-up between industry and academia happens, and the scientific institutions happens, and again, comes out with some models for the rest of the country as well, where we are able to produce some wonderful solutions. Ajit Rangnekar, who is the former dean of Indian School of Business, he's heading this effort called RICH, and I do hope Dr. Chandrasekhar, Mr. Mohan Rao Garu, and Professor Mehta can also bless. There's an initiative of the government wherein we are trying to solve some real world problems. So my compliments to Telangana Academy of Sciences. My congratulations to all the young fellows who are winning awards today. Like Mr. Mehta said, I'm sure you'll reflect back on this day and as a day when you've won an award and where you've also heard a very long, boring speech. But nevertheless, I think I wish you all the very best and good luck to Telangana Academy of Sciences. And the one request that has been made by Professor Reddy with respect to allocation of land and some grant, I do not have it in my purview to sanction it immediately as much as I would have loved to. So therefore, I'll take it to the Honorable Chief Minister's notice. If you can give me something in writing formally, I will definitely endeavor that we'll get you something quickly. Thank you very much and good luck.